has finally come. We are going to be reading Iron Freaking Flame. And before we actually jump into starting this book, I do have a little bit of a confession. I have read a little under 100 pages because, like an idiot, I tried filming this video and starting this book this past weekend, but it is absolutely impossible for me to film reading vlogs while other people are home. It still like is a little embarrassing for me to talk in a room by myself, but more so this camera just like picks up every little noise, and apparently the walls in this house are paper thin. So now it's Tuesday, I am home alone, we're restarting this video, and it has been absolutely killing me, especially after reading 100 pages almost, to have to like put it aside for days. Also too, by the way, this is gonna be like a full spoiler reading vlog. I wasn't really expecting, especially within the first 100 pages, to really have that much to talk about, but as you can see, I did tab quite a bit. I feel like every few pages I was just like, so I want to be able to like give you good details about like what's surprising me or what I'm upset about or happy about and that kind of thing. And before we actually jump into the first 100 pages that I've read so far, I kind of wanted to give you my thoughts kind of going into the book. The first thing that I want to address is the obvious cliffhanger that Fourth Wing left us off with. Violet's brother is alive. I feel like that was one of those types of cliffhangers that I should have been able to predict, but I totally did not. I had no idea that was coming, and I was very excited about it. That being said, I was kind of concerned going into Iron Flame that the cliffhanger was going to be kind of left alone for a little bit. I got a little scarred earlier on this year with the Scythe series. The second book in that series leaves off on the biggest freaking cliffhanger, and it took almost half of the third book for them to like fully address what the second book had left off with. Horrendous. So I was really concerned that this was gonna do kind of like the same thing, but this book basically picks up exactly where Fourth Wing left off on. And then the other major concern that I had was the fact that the school aspect of Fourth Wing was one of my favorite parts. Also the whole like dragon trials thing. Those were the two big reasons why I wanted to read Fourth Wing. And I felt like by the end of Fourth Wing, those two things were gone. They all have dragons at that point, they all have powers, and again, with the whole resistance and stuff like that that happened at the very end of Fourth Wing, I was like, there's no way they can go back to school, but they almost immediately go back to school, which I'm very excited for. Although I will say, I wish they did allow Violet a little bit more time with her brother before they went to school. I feel like that happened really, really quickly, and I feel like specifically because it was the cliffhanger of Fourth Wing, I'm really hoping that this is not the last that we see of Brennan. So those were kind of like my thoughts and kind of, I guess, mostly concerns going into Iron Flame. Now let's go ahead and actually talk about the first 90 pages that I have read so far and kind of catch you up to where I'm at. The first thing that I kind of like jotted down was about Violet's second dragon, her golden dragon, which I think is Adarna is how I've been pronouncing it in my head. I don't know if that's correct, but I totally forgot about her cliffhanger. At the end of Fourth Wing, it did mention that she had changed and gotten much bigger. And I'm gonna be honest, not loving that storyline so far. In Fourth Wing, she was just this like sweet little like baby dragon. And now with Iron Flame, so far she's just an irritable, bratty teenage dragon. I don't like the negative downside of her character so far. Also too, just like bratty characters in general annoy me. Where I'm at right now, I think she has just fallen into her like dream sleep period or whatever it's called, where the adolescent or teenage like dragons sleep for months on end. So I'm hoping kind of like when she wakes up, she's more so like an adult and not gonna keep being this like attitude filled little dragon. But also too, it does kind of feel like maybe the author didn't really know what to do with her character or like that dragon specifically wasn't gonna be a big player in this book. So they're just gonna have or like be asleep for the majority of it. But we'll see how that goes. And then the first thing that actually got me really excited about this book is the introduction of the Rider Survival Course, which was introduced on page 56. We're getting more trials and I am so excited for it. So far that hasn't really played a part yet. I'm only like 30 pages past the point where it got introduced. So I don't know what is gonna be entailed in that exactly, but it's supposed to obviously help them learn how to survive. We also did meet Liam's sister, which I totally also forgot about that story plot. Liam dying in Fourth Wing was the most devastating thing ever. I freaking loved Liam, but That being said, I was kind of surprised at how many times they kept bringing Liam up. I understand it was sad, but like that happened in the last book, like let's move on. But then we had the new first years coming into the school and Liam's sister was one of them. And I was like, oh yeah, Violet had promised Liam that she was going to take care of his sister. So the fact that Liam's sister hates her is hilarious to me. I kind of love it. And I'm excited to see the dynamic of that kind of continue throughout the story. And then the other thing that I've actually been finding to be super, super interesting is being able to see the first years through our like OG cast's eyes, because now they're all second years or second and third years. I'm hoping they keep continuing on with that because that's been a lot of fun. We also do have another new character. He hasn't really played too much of a part yet. It's basically the king's son, which I feel like this is also the first time we're hearing about a king. I don't remember a king being in the first book, but that also could just be my crappy memory. But I'm interested to see how that's gonna play out. And then finally, on page 84, I just wrote down what the f- Nadine, out of nowhere, gets her freaking neck snapped. To be fair, in Fourth Wing, Nadine was like not a character that I cared about, I don't think. But in this book so far, they have like built her up to, you know, be like a likable character, or at least a character that you somewhat care about, just to kill her off. Pretty much at that point, I was like, okay, I need to put this book down so we can do this together, because clearly there's just gonna be things popping up right, left, and center. So obviously I did still read a couple more pages because I couldn't help myself, but we did stop on page 90 and that's kind of where I'm at right now. Let's get back to reading. I am literally so excited. I saw a TikTok that was kind of like poking fun at the fact that there's supposed to be 5 books in this series and the 2 like love interests already got together in the first book, and I was kind of curious to see how that was going to play out, because obviously once they get together the tension is completely gone for me. But the fact that they're kind of like having some issues is definitely kind of rebuilding some tension, which I do really appreciate. That being said, I hope this kind of issue doesn't take too long to kind of resolve, because it kind of reminds me of like the miscommunication trope. That's annoying. Like, just talk it out, get over it. Back a little bit what I said about their issue kind of stretching on. I don't want them to get with other people, but he basically keeps telling her, do what you want, do what you want. So I kind of want, not actually for real do it, but like test the waters with that and see his reaction, because I think that'd be great. I feel like she should just like trust him that he can't tell her everything, but at the same time I can understand like her being upset that he won't, because like, why not at this point? You know what I mean? Like, are we not past this yet? Because if I was her, that would piss me off. Like, you're the one being the unreasonable one, and then you're also gonna tell me that I could do whatever I want? Okay. Okay, we'll see about that, pal. Good news, Violet and Zayden kissed, which leads me to believe that their like issue is not gonna be like the whole story, which I'm happy for, but also it didn't leave off with them like getting back together. So I'm happy that the tension building is still gonna be there. So that's what I have to say for the romance stuff so far. As far as everything else, I loathe Varish, which is kind of funny because when I first read the synopsis, it mentioned Varish. I didn't exactly understand at the time who he was. I thought he was kind of going to be the new Zayden. So I was kind of thinking that there might be potentially like a love triangle situation. I could not. It's comical how far from the truth that was. I'm at the point where Violet just got done being essentially tortured by him because Adarna didn't show up for the flight training or whatever. But then on the other side of the coin, I'm getting like kind of like pumped and excited for the fact that like everyone is around her, like Imogen and Bodhi and things like that. I love when a group of people just like get together with a common mission and kick butt, which also I'm loving the fact that like Imogen and Violet are becoming like besties. It's kind of my favorite thing. We've officially started our first survival trial thing, and someone has died. Also, too, I'm just like really excited that everyone seems to kind of be starting to get more in the loop. I feel like after every like chapter, we're just getting deeper and deeper into this, like everyone's coming together more and more for this common cause, and I'm so excited, even though half of them don't even know what the cause is yet, but they're all starting to like understand that something weird is going on. And like I'm enjoying the ride of this book so far, but I'm like so excited for everything to like come together. It's a few hours later, it's like 7 o'clock. I ate dinner, kind of putzed around on my computer for a little bit, and I'm back to reading. I'm currently on page 182, and Varish is trying to punish Violet again for Andarna not being at the flight training, and it's getting pretty tense. Not only did Varish have to apologize, he had to do it on his knees. Taryn is now my favorite. I'm currently getting ready to work out. I have a little pre-workout to sip on, and while I drink this, I wanted to kind of read a little bit more of our book. But before I do that, I need to update you on what I read last night. I was originally going to stop on page 200, but I read to 257 because I just couldn't help myself. We finally got an update on freaking Eric slash Cam slash the third son of the king. I feel like they brought him up and then didn't talk about him for like the longest time, but we finally got an update and we just found out that he knows about what's going on outside of Basgaeth, which makes sense because he's the king's son, so I would assume that the king knows. So that was actually exciting that we found out, because I'm glad that there's like another person that knows about that. But also, at this point in time, I'm getting very confused as to like who knows about what's going on. The whole rebellion thing, everything that like Violet and her friends kind of experienced at the end of Fourth Wing, like why of all places? I mean, I understand that this is like a war college, but why of all places is a school like the hub of the people that do seem to know what's going on? Which, by the way, brings up another point that was kind of frustrating me last night. How is it that Dane's dad got like shipped away for sending Violet and her friends to like their death essentially, but Varish is able to like torture her very openly on like a day-to-day basis? Why is no one waving a red flag? Like, how is no one noticing this? And then that leads me into the other thing that I was like super shocked by, but not in a good way. Jack is back. Why? We already have a new villain in Varish. Like, I don't need an old one from the first book to reappear. If Liam has to stay dead, Jack should as well, you know? So I'm a little irritated by that, honestly. And I just feel like the book doesn't need it, especially because the buildup of it was like kind of dramatic. They've kind of hinted at the healer working on this like secret project. There's been theories kind of floating around in the book. And I just feel like Jack being the thing is very anticlimactic. I wasn't expecting to update this soon. I've literally read two pages. But Violin and Zayden are meeting up with some griffins, one of which is a female that is apparently looking at him as if she's trudging through a desert and he's the oasis. And earlier in the book, I think it was Imogen had mentioned to Violet kind of offhandedly that he felt for her even stronger than he did for some other random person. And I bet you this is some other random person. Okay, they just said her name was Kat. I wish I had marked where she said her name. I'm pretty sure it's her, though, because, like, who else could it be? Especially because she apparently just glared at Violet. She has no reason to hate Violet other than if she loves Zayden, you know? It was just confirmed. That's the girl. And the last sentence of the chapter is, oh, gods, the way she looked at him wasn't just longing. It was memory. Dun, dun, dun. I had to stop my treadmill walk for a second because finally, another person at this friggin' school is starting to push back on Varish. We have two professors within just a couple of pages, one of them giving Violet like a little bit of advice and then the other one standing up for her. Finally. Also too, the last kind of encounter has helped me remember a little bit more about what was going on in Fourth Wing. So I'm kind of understanding the politics and things a little bit better. Still confused as to the fact that somehow the hub of this secret is coming from the school and yet the majority of the professors seem to not know what's going on. Anyway, I'm gonna get back to my walk, but feeling better. I'm currently on page 278. I just have a feeling something bad is about to happen, so I figured I'd turn the camera on. Threshing for first years just happened, and Rhiannon got a message from Jesenia telling them to like meet her in 15 minutes. And, oh, which by the way, everyone knows now, I'm so excited. Literally right after, you know, the one professor stood up for Violet against Varish, Rhiannon also ended up having to help with that situation as well. And I am so excited about that, especially because we do still have like half of the book left. I was really hoping that they would find out sooner than later because I love a group effort. But I'm at the point where Violet is going to her watch and Riddick is the one that's gonna be meeting Jesenia. And I just have a really bad feeling that something is gonna happen to him. And I don't want anyone in the core four to die. So I just feel like the lead up to this is just too like happy-go-lucky, we're all a team. Is something bad gonna happen to Violet? Something bad is gonna happen to Violet. Or Aya, it looks like. I don't know if I'm saying anybody's name right. I think Aya is the one that's gonna die. I'm so confused! I thought her dragon was gonna come swooping in to save her, but it was Jack. I mean, they keep mentioning that he's like nice now, but I don't trust it. They don't trust it. I thought he was gonna like fake being nice so that he could just get like closer to her and then kill her, but that would have been a perfect opportunity for him to just let her die, and he didn't. So I'm confused. But also, why was he there? So again, is this a setup? Did he like save her just to, I don't know. Dane and Zayden just rescued Violet from Varish in the dungeons or whatever. And like I mentioned yesterday, one of my big concerns going into this book was because of the way Fourth Wing ended, I didn't see a way that they would be able to return back to the school. Now I really can't see a way that they can return back to the school. I'm basically like halfway through this book at this point and all hell has just broken loose. And also very excited that Varish is now dead. So there's that as well. It's been literally 2 seconds, but Violet's mom just joined the freaking party. I'm currently on page 375, and I'm gonna be honest, I don't remember. Actually, I think the last thing I said was that basically all hell is breaking loose. The mom has joined the party. Mom did not join the party. We basically just found out that she kind of knew about everything that was going on, and the only reason that she hasn't, I guess, sided with like the good guys is that she was trying to keep her kids alive. Which makes me wonder why, at this point, especially because now all of her children are together. Like, Mira has also joined this group at Ryerson House. Obviously, Brennan's there, Violet's there. A bunch of cadets from Bazgaiath, but then also a bunch of, like, active, I don't know what they're called, like, active members of the military that have already graduated have also joined. So I'm wondering why the mom has now not joined their side of this fight. Like, why is she still on the other side? But on, like, a better note, we are actually still getting the school-ish type setting, which is kind of fun. Some of the professors from Bazgaiath had also followed the cadets as well to Ryerson House, and the people that were already at Ryerson House and the professors have kind of made, like, their own version of Bazgaiath. So, like, they still have the battle brief, but they're now telling the cadets actually what's going on for real. And I just finished off where Felix was helping Violet kind of train her powers, because apparently she can wield her powers in a lot more efficient and different ways than she thought, which makes more sense because everyone's, like, so blown away by the fact that she can wield lightning, but so far it hasn't really been that impressive. And honestly, when I found out about her power originally when I was reading Fourth Wing, I was kind of like, oh, I was expecting it to be cooler. But apparently she's supposed to be able to wield it in more ways than what she has been so far. So I'm excited about kind of following her through that, kind of learning more about her powers and things. However, she just ended off the session by telling him that she wants to learn, and then quietly to herself, like her own thoughts, says, as soon as I get back, because she's gonna go and get the luminary or whatever it is. And the whole reason she's doing that is because she feels guilty for making a, like, impulse decision. So basically she's doing the classic trying to fix a rash decision by making another rash decision, which is inevitably, classically, gonna get everyone in even more trouble. So it's just like, ugh. But also I can't wait to read it. I love the fact that Zayden was, like, waiting for Violet, which is funny because while I was reading, I was thinking, like, he should know by now that if he just flat out tells her no and it's something that she feels strongly about, she's gonna do it anyway. Also too, a very random side note, I love that he calls her Violence. Hello, it's the next day. It's our last day of reading Iron Flame, and some stuff has happened. We just got done with the attack on Violet, Sloane, Kat, and Visaya. Yet another character they build you up to like just to cut them down. So that was unfortunate, but we did get a really good bonding moment between Violet and Kat with that, which I liked. And then also, obviously, Sloane has kind of been warming up slowly but surely with Violet, which I knew was gonna happen. But now I feel like we've turned a corner where, like, even Violet now is aware that there's really no problem between her and Sloane anymore. So love that. And the part that I very, very specifically just left off on, Violet asking what Zayden's second power is, which is kind of funny because while they were, like, walking through the caves before they got attacked, and Darna is with them, so it made me think more about the fact that obviously I knew she had two dragons, but I never really thought too much about it because her second one hasn't really been in the story all that much. But she was very present in this moment in the story, and it made me think about the fact that she does have two dragons, so does that mean that she's gonna have two powers? And all this whole time, Zayden had one. And obviously they got interrupted before we could find out what his second power is. Not that it seemed like he wanted to tell her, which he's mad because she's not asking him questions, and then she asked that and he was like, I feel like there was something else I wanted to say and I didn't mark anything yesterday because I was like, oh, I'm definitely gonna remember. I don't remember. I guess that's the only update that I have. Her and Dane are fine. Oh, that's what it was. It was about Dane. So I watched a little blip of an interview with Rebecca Yarros. The interviewer asked her, like, something along the lines of, like, do you have a quote that'll get people to want to read the book or something like that? And she was basically like, I don't have a quote, but here's, like, a line that's gonna make people go crazy. And it was, I reached for Dane's belt buckle. And I knew it wasn't gonna be, like, what it was insinuating, which is basically that Violet was, like, at some point gonna be undressing Dane. But that has not stopped me from, like, waiting for this moment. And we finally got it. So stupid. literally Dane wasn't even near her when it happened. And it was such like a non-thing to the story that my brain didn't even like register that I had read that sentence until like a couple sentences later. So she like clickbaited her own book. Also, Violet does know how to put the wards up, but it does mean that the flyers are gonna lose their powers or something like that. So she was trying to give them like some time to like leave or, you know, make a decision basically on whether they feel comfortable with that or not. And now what's interrupted Zayden and Violet's talk about Zayden's second freaking power is them in a situation where they're gonna have to put up the wards like ASAP, which I'm excited for. So anyway, that's where I'm at. And like I said, I have about 100 pages left, so let's knock this book out. And I'm just kind of crossing my fingers that the ending isn't gonna be disappointing. When Fourth Wing came out, I feel like all of the reviews were basically people just loving it and obsessed with it. But for this one, I feel like the reviews have been very mixed. And I feel like specifically the ending is what is causing people's strife. So I'm a little concerned about the ending of this, but we'll see. I think we're about to find out what Zayden's second power is, which I was not expecting. I've literally read like 2 pages and I was kind of assuming that they were gonna like draw that out, but I'm so glad that they're not, and it better be something good. He basically just insinuated that if she finds out what the power is, she's not gonna love him anymore, which makes me feel like it must be something that he's used on her and she'll know once she knows, you know? I could be totally wrong, but that's what I'm getting. She's trying to guess, and he just told her to stop, so I think she's getting close. This is taking quite a long time to figure out. I have mixed feelings about this. So he reads minds. Definitely a cool power. That's probably one of the ones that I would want. So worth the buildup. Clearly, like I said, it's something that immediately she's gonna know that it's been used on her, because how would he have not ever in the entire time that they've known each other not read her mind at some point? So clearly he's used it without her knowing. Not cool. But I feel like she's about to fly off the handle, and I feel like at the end of the day, is it really that bad? Okay, I should have read like one more sentence before I started speaking. I still have the same thoughts, but he's not actually a mind reader. He reads intentions, which is slightly less cool, but it should soften the blow with Violet. I honestly don't want this to be a thing. I've decided officially, I don't want this to be a thing. If she blows this up into a gigantic ordeal, all it's done is help them. So like, let's move on, you know? Well, I guess Zayden is a Venon now. Cool. Hi guys, it's a few days after the last clip that you saw. I essentially took kind of the weekend to compose myself, get my thoughts together, but then also I did do a good chunk of the editing for this video, and I realized that there were a couple of things that I mentioned in the video, like a thought process or a theory that I had, and then I never like followed through with that thought process throughout the rest of the video. So basically I have collected a little page of notes that I kind of want to go over, but I do want to go over them very quickly because again, I have been editing the video and it's currently sitting at like 40 minutes. So we need to just like wrap it up already, you know? First off, I didn't mention at all somehow during the filming process of this video about the fact that Endarna is not a black dragon. I did kind of like text out in the very, very beginning of the video that it was like foreshadowing what I was talking about, the fact that she wasn't gonna play a big role in this book. She played one of the biggest roles in this book. The female relationships in this book are my absolute favorite thing. I kind of was disappointed originally that Zayden wasn't really like the biggest presence in this book overall, but honestly, I mean, I hope to see more of him in the next one, but I do kind of like the fact that because he wasn't around as much, Violet had to make these other relationships. And again, I just love that it was all like female friendships. It's just my favorite freaking thing. And then another thing that I really, really liked about this book was that nobody in the core four died. We did have a couple of like dramatic side character deaths, but we didn't have any main character deaths. But that being said, I do feel like that probably means, I'm predicting it now, that in the third book, a main character, a beloved character, is going to perish, which I'm already sad for. And now, last but not least, I have a couple of like closing out thoughts. After Fourth Wing, I was like, there's no way they're gonna be able to go back to school. Midway through this book, I was like, there's really no way. But at the end of the book, Zayden did mention to Violet that Basgaiath, because the wards are back up, is now the safest place for her. So I think they're gonna be back in school, which I'm excited for. But that kind of makes me wonder what's gonna happen to the flyers, because the cadets at Basgaiath and the flyers are kind of more intermingled. I can't see a situation where they're just gonna like separate and be like, okay, peace out now. So I'm wondering if the flyers are gonna be a part of Basgaiath, and then also how is that gonna work, because under the wards, they don't have powers, which I feel like is gonna be a main reason that maybe they don't go to Basgaiath. But again, I'm kind of wanting those two groups to stay together. So I'm very curious to see how that's gonna kind of like play out in the next book. And then last, but certainly not least, Violet is going to be having a second signet. And apparently, according to the author, there was a bunch of hints throughout this book for you to be able to guess what it is. So far, the one that I saw on TikTok that feels like it makes the most sense is the fact that she can slow down time. First of all, she already had that, which also is what makes it kind of feel like maybe that's not gonna be it, because that would be too obvious. But the person in the TikTok did make a good like argument for it. Basically, they were talking about how Violet is always like hyper aware of what's going on with her friends, like in the middle of battle. And I remember thinking while I was reading that, that seemed very unrealistic for her to be able to do. But I just kind of figured, because the book is in Violet's perspective, that it was just the author's way of kind of like describing what was going on. But again, it is a good argument for the fact that maybe she can slow down time and is able to like, you know, hyper focus and kind of see what's happening. Also, she's just very good at fighting in general and aim with her little knives and things. So it would make sense for her to be able to like be more perceptive in that manner. If you have any theories of your own as to what Violet's second signet is, I would love to hear them. With that, those are all of my thoughts and my feelings and my experience reading Iron Flame by Rebecca Yarros.